Hey there, I'm so thrilled that you joined us today. My name is Shade and I want to welcome you to Manna Church. Today, we're diving into part two of our current sermon series, When Your Back's Against the Wall. Later on during our experience, we'll have a time where we'll take communion together. If you've asked Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life, I invite you to participate. You don't need to have the special wafer and grape juice or wine. All you need to do is grab something to drink and something to eat. But first, let's prepare our hearts as Manna Worship leads us in worship through song.
Manna Church, welcome. We're so glad you could join us. If you're not already on your feet, go ahead and stand up. Let's worship together.
Joy you bring, all because of your great love. Now I live. I was dead, but now I'm free. Awakened to your grace, so free. The power of your cross. Now I live.
Sing salvation.
Salvation.
Hey again. We are so excited that you're here. I would like to welcome those of you who may be joining us for the first time here on Manna Online. If that's you, we want to thank you so much for being our guest. There's a simple way to let us know that you are here with us. I invite you to text the word guest to the number that you see on your screen right now. Go ahead and pause if you need to. If you're watching this on our website, manna.church, you can either text or you can click the button under the screen that says first time guest. Now, you may have been watching Manna Online for quite some time now, but you haven't let us know yet. And if that's you, we would really like to hear from you. I invite you to go ahead and text the word guest to the number that you see on your screen as well. We have a team that wants to contact you this week to see how we can serve you and help you get connected. So thank you again for joining us, and we hope that you'll join us again very soon. At this time, I want to invite you to participate in worship through giving. We give of our finances to the Lord as a way of demonstrating to Him that we are putting Him first and that we are following His ways. If you currently give online through the web or the Manna Church app, continue to do so. If you would like to give online today, you can simply give via PayPal simply by texting the word MANNA to the number that you see on your screen. If you would like to write a check, make it out to Manna Church. You can also mail it in or drop it off at our Cliffdale site in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region. If you're a guest today, please feel no obligation to give financially. Let's pray now over the offering. God, we thank you so much for being the ultimate provider. You provide for every single one of our needs. And so we give back a portion of what you've provided for us to you because it belongs to you first. We demonstrate our trust in you and we pray that you would have your way with these tithes and offerings, God, that you would use them to advance your kingdom here in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region and all across the globe along the military highway. May your kingdom come and may your will be done in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let's head back into worship through song.
Come on, let's worship our God who's seated at the right hand of God on the throne. Amen. Grace.
As I mentioned earlier, we're taking communion together during our experience. If you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want to invite you to participate in communion. Go ahead and grab those elements as we prepare. When Jesus was with us, he left us with some traditions. We call those traditions sacraments. Jesus said, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Communion is a reminder of our intimate connection and ongoing relationship with Jesus. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So whatever element you have as your bread to represent his body, take and eat at this time. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. You may drink at this time." 1 Corinthians 11 says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you so much for being the Lord and Savior of our lives. We thank you that we can do this in remembrance of you and what you've done for us in the way that you made for us. Thank you for giving us access to everything that you have set aside for us. We praise you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We're almost ready to dive into part two of our current sermon series, When Your Back is Against the Wall. But before we do, check out these video announcements.
Your rock offering contributions have allowed us to partner with local nonprofit Noonday Kitchen to fill an essential need in our community. For many children in Cumberland County and in Hope County, attending public school is more than just going to class. They rely on public school systems to feed them lunch, which means that during the summer months, access to this essential meal gets drastically diminished. This is where our ministry partner, Noonday Kitchen, comes in. For the past two summers, through their program, Summer Lunch Break, Noonday Kitchen has served thousands of meals to children all throughout Cumberland and Hope counties who qualify for free lunch during the summer but are unable to access it due to a lack of transportation. Noonday Kitchen brings fresh meals directly to their residential areas. Thanks to your generous praying and giving, in June and July of this year, over 3,000 meals were served to families in need in our community.
We started this kind of with the idea that we know that a healthy and an active faith, a true mark of that is a changed community. So we wanted to get in here, change our communities, remind people that we often see overlooked that there is a God who sees them and that they deserve to eat well. Again, we're super grateful that you guys have been supporting us. You have no idea how many lives you guys have touched.
Hey, Manna Church, my name is Anna Wiggins, and I want to talk to you for just a moment about baptism. Baptism is a big deal. It's something that Jesus told all of his followers to do. Now, we give out shirts that say, "This is my story," because if you're a follower of Jesus, this is my story and it's your story, that we were once dead in our sins, but through Christ Jesus, we have been raised to life again. Now, if you're a follower of Jesus and you've never taken the step to outwardly proclaim that through water baptism, I want to invite you to take the next step in your journey with Jesus by signing up for baptism today.
Hey everybody, Pastor Michael here. Welcome to week two of our series entitled When Your Back is Against the Wall, based on Psalm 143, which incidentally is one of my favorite psalms, and you'll see why as we dig deeper in it today. So this series is a bit unique, and let me take a moment and explain to you why. Most sermon series are linear in nature. Here's what I mean by that. They go section to section to section, or point to point to point, or one verse to the next verse, one section to the next section, one idea to the next idea. They're linear in motion, kind of going like this. This service is different. This series is different. We will camp in this one psalm and cover all 12 verses every single week, emphasizing certain verses this week more than we did over the same verse the week before or the week after. So in a sense, this sermon series is kind of like this. We touch on this, we touch on that, we go a little bit deeper. And why would you do this, Michael? I mean, it seems like these kind of sermon series work fine. Why would you have one that's kind of like this? Why would you do that? Because several reasons. Number one, repetition is the mother of memory. And I really want you to catch this, especially the part we call the process. Listen to me. And when I get to that, I'll go a little deeper. But if you can catch the process, if you can understand the process, if you can remember it and put it into practice, it'll absolutely change your life. It'll give you a tool set you did not have before in your walk with God. So repetition is the mother of memory, and the best way that we could get you to learn this is by going over it again and again and again and again. And the second reason why we've chose this pattern is because this psalm can really change your life. Better said, God can change your life with these 12 but powerful verses. And so we wanna make sure that we give them their due and kind of take them in and chew them up a little bit and swallow them, come back the next week and get a little bit more just from a little bit of a different angle. So the question is, how many times have you been in a place where it feels like your back's against the wall? And if we're honest, we've all been there. We've all been there. Some of you may be there right now. So do you think we're going to be in there again some other time with our back against the wall? Probably. I mean, look at 2020. Some people, if not many people, are still stuck in some place back there where they're back against the wall. There's still some stuff that's the residual of that going on in our lives that puts us sometimes in a difficult place in life. So the kindest thing we can do is to teach you how to apply this powerful passage, these 12 little verses, so that you can walk in freedom. So here we go, back where we've already been to find something new. But first, speaking of having your back against the wall, four men were in a hospital waiting room, and because their wives were having babies. The nurse comes in to the first guy and says, "Congratulations, you're the father of twins." And the man says, "Well, it's a crazy coincidence because I work for the Minnesota Twins." The nurse goes to the second man, "Congratulations, sir, you're the father of triplets." The man says, "Wow, that's a crazy coincidence because I work for 3M Company." The nurse goes to the third guy and says, "Congratulations, you're the father of quadruplets." The man says, "Man, amazing, that's crazy, because I work for Four Seasons Hotel." And the last guy was freaking out, running around, banging his head against the wall. The nurse says, sir, calm down, are you okay?" He says, "No, I'm shafted, I work for 7-Up. That would be, Okay, Psalm 143, verses 1 through 12. Let me read the psalm to you, but first, let me pause and take a look at this outline. So first of all, we got a problem. And the problem is verses 1 through 4, David's back is against the wall. And we're gonna watch David. We're gonna walk through this psalm and watch how David responds to his back being against the wall to inform and to instruct us on how we should respond when we find ourselves in the same situation. And I said a moment ago, it all centers on these two little verses. I mean, isn't God so, just these two little verses, God is so amazing. If you catch this process, I'm telling you, it will revolutionize your life from the inside out. And so David understands it. He understands the process. Matter of fact, he's the one writing the psalm. It's almost like we're getting to look into his prayer journal as he says, "This is how you do this." Or we're sitting in a sermon series and David's the one who's talking and saying, "This is how you do this." So he walks us through the process, which sets us up to pray these very 7 powerful, tiny little prayers. And each week we're gonna take a look at another one of those. And then finally, we close the psalm in Psalm 143, last couple of verses, the preservation. So let's jump in at verse 1 and I'll kind of read and comment all the way through. David says, "Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my pleas for mercy. In your faithfulness, answer me in your righteousness. So what's interesting is that David's back is against the wall and he's in trouble. He's in trouble on the inside. He's in trouble on the outside, as we're going to see in a moment. But the key, and I really want you to catch this, David is not going to try and muscle his way out of this. He's been in these kind of situations before. If you're a reader of the Psalms, you have seen that over and over again. He's going to go to God for help. So he knows. I mean, he's been here before. He's been in a cave. He's been running from Saul. He's been running from Absalom, all of that stuff. And he talks about, Lord, my life is ending. I'm in trouble. I'm never going to get out of this. You've got to rescue me. You've got to do something for me. But you know, in the past, you've been good to me. And you've always come through when I ask. And there was that one time when I had to fight the lion. And one time I had to fight the bear. You gave me victory and I overcame that. And then you teach my hands to war and I'm going to fight against my enemies and I'll overcome and I'm a victor. And you want to say, David, stop, dude. I mean, it sounds great, but you're still in the cave. Because see, David knows it's not about getting out of the situation, it's about getting God into the situation. David knows that. And while he isn't specific about exactly what his trouble is and what caused it, he's very clear. He's very specific about what he's asking for from God. He says, in your faithfulness, answer me in your righteousness. So faithfulness means you're dependable. Answer me in your faithfulness. God, I can depend on you. You are good. And righteous means you're true. You always and only do what is right. And so you don't know the number of times I've prayed that prayer. Lord, I don't know what's going on, but I know this. You are good and you always and only do what is right. See, sometimes we get into situations we don't understand. We ask God questions and the number one question is why? As if knowing will get us out of our situation. But sometimes it's not just the question, it's a little bit of pushback. We actually go beyond the question and have, if we're honest, struggles with God. God, why would you allow this? God, why would you bring me into this? God, I thought I've been through this before. God, I thought you brought me out of this. Where are you? Why won't you help me? Why am I by myself? See, David settles it here. He says, Lord, you are good and you always and only do what is right. Verse 2. Enter not into judgment with your servant, for no one living is righteous before you. Now, he's got troubles within, and I love, he doesn't say what they are, but what he's doing here, he's admitting that he's a sinner, and that it's possible, if not probable, that some of what he's into in terms of his back being against the wall is the result of his own sinfulness, the result of his inherent sinfulness. Then he goes on in verse 3 and says, your enemy has pursued my soul. He's crushed my life to the ground. He's made me sit in darkness like those long dead. Some people say that this psalm is written about Saul chasing David. It can't be because he wasn't chasing David's soul. He was chasing David's life. Maybe Absalom, he was also chasing David's life. See, I don't think we know. And I don't think God wants us to know. We don't know if it's that the enemy's a person, if it's a betrayer, maybe a former friend, maybe it's a foe who's been a foe his whole entire life. Maybe it's spiritual. Maybe it's the devil. It doesn't matter how he got here. The point is that David's back is against the wall and he's in pain. And I love how this gives plenty of latitude to fit your life and my life into this psalm, which sets us up to pray these seven powerful prayers that will permeate our condition. And so let me just say this. Sometimes, and I'm gonna say something about pastors for a moment. Sometimes pastors pretend perfection. So we act like we got everything together. And we feel like if you ever find out we don't have everything together, you won't want to follow us. But let me just tell you, that's just so unrealistic. You don't want a pastor who's perfect. You want a pastor who knows how to get a hold of God. And that's the same with David. I mean, David is not a perfect character. As you look at him in the Old Testament, there's a lot wrong with him. And there's a lot to be disagreed with. But here's a guy who knows how to get a hold of God. So the thing is not faking it till you make it and trying to pretend that you got everything under control. It's more important to be real and know how to get a hold of God so that God can get in your circumstances and turn things the way he would have them go, not necessarily the way that you would have them go. It says, for an enemy has pursued my soul. Therefore, verse 4, therefore my soul faints within me, my heart within me is appalled. He's saying his spirit faints. In other words, I'm out of gas. I'm worn out from trying and I can't believe how bad things are inside. My heart within me is appalled. Appalled is a strong word. My heart within me is appalled. In other words, I just can't believe it. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been with your back against the wall? Have you ever been in a place where you just feel like you're stuck? Maybe it's in your marriage or your money. Maybe it's with one or more of your children. Maybe it's your job. Maybe you're just behind and you seem to be behind in life, period, and you just can't catch up. Maybe it's depression. Maybe it's anxiety. Maybe it's fear. I don't know, but this brings us to the process. And I said a few moments ago, and I'm going to say all throughout this series for all 7 weeks, that the process is the most important point. The process is the methodology, if I can use that term, that David uses to get God into the circumstance. And you can do this. You can memorize these four tiny little ideas. The first is this: I remember. I remember the days of old. In other words, I go backward to go forward. I recall how you've been there for me in the past, how these were better days and those were better days. And I remember growing up when you spoke this to me. And I remember when I was Samuel anointed me with oil, and what a great day that was. And it filled my heart with joy and anticipation. I choose to remember the display of your power in my past. Then he moves on to what some people might think is a synonym, but it's not. It's actually a little bit more specific. I meditate on all that you've done. The word meditate here is not transcendental meditation. It's a deliberate act to choose to go over and over, to ruminate on the details of past deliverances. This is personal. This may take your entire devotional time. Let me just stop right here and just dive in here for just a moment. And I'm going to dig into this a little more next week, but let me just say as kind of a starter this week that the Psalms are like David's journal. And I kind of mimicked this for you a few moments ago when I said, you know, I'm in a cave, I'm being chased, the guy wants to kill me, people are betraying me, I'm done. Lord, I don't have any more energy left. And yet in the old days, so now he's gonna remember. Now in the old days, Lord, you helped me when I was young and I was a shepherd on the hills, and the lion, the bear came and you saved me. And then he moves on to meditate on the deliverances that he's had. And there was the time I went to battle against the Philistines and you gave me 10,000, and the people sang that Saul has his thousands and David his 10,000s, and you worked powerfully through me. And he goes on like that and he says, you trained my hands to war, you've delivered me from my enemies. All my enemies are underneath my feet. And you want to go, no, sir, the enemies are outside the cave. They're coming in after you. You're going to have to pick up your stuff, close your journal, and run. But you see, there's a process here, because David, what he's doing is he's saying, I am not going to take responsibility to do this by my own strength. I'm going to put myself in your hands, and I'm going to stand by and watch you deliver me piece by piece, step by step. David, if he's good at anything, that he's an expert at. That's why the Psalms are our teacher, because they are the journals, if you will, of King David. And so here he says, I meditate on all you've done. This is personal. And you may have to push aside your reading plan for a moment and just stop and think before God and talk to him and remember what he's done for you. And then he says, I ponder the work of your hands. In other words, I think about how great you are. He intentionally sitting there in that cave, cold, dark, thinking about how great God is. But all that you've done, this is not personal. This is almost like a proposition, like you're stating propositions, almost theological. He says, I see the stars, the vastness of the ocean. I see the grandeur of the mountains. I feel the fierceness of the thunder and lightning, the work of your hands. And what's my response? He says in verse 6, I stretch out my hands to you. So here's a guy, he's at the end of his rope, and now he's in worship. He says, my soul, watch this, my soul thirsts for you like a parched land. My insides are beginning to understand it's not about my outside, it's about my connection with you. His only response is to lift up his hands as he's confronted with the power of God's hands. When you worship from a place of pain, it is some of the most powerful worship. Hebrews, we read this last week. We'll read it again next week. Why? Because we're going to go deeper and deeper and deeper. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15 calls it the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. See, before David settled the fact, you're good, you only and always do what is right, but I'm not going to muscle this. I'm going to let you deliver me. Now that he's in that place, he's ready to pray these seven prayers. He's in the right headspace. He's in the right posture to pray these seven prayers. And so let's do that. Let's read through them. And I'll come back and comment on the second prayer in just a few moments. Answer me quickly, O Lord, my spirit fails. The key word, the key idea is desperation. We looked at that prayer last week. It's such a powerful, powerful thing. God responds. God is attracted to desperation when faith is added to it. Second prayer, hide not your face from me, lest I become like those who go down to the pit. And the key idea there is the presence of God. Let me tell you something. When the presence of God comes into your situation, everything begins to change. More on that in just a couple of moments. He says, verse 8, let me hear in the morning your steadfast love, for in you I trust. We're going to talk about hearing from God when we get to that prayer. Make me know the way I should go. Guide me, Lord, for to you I lift up my soul. Notice he's not saying I'm trying to get out of the troubles. He's not trying to get out of his troubles. He's trying to get God into his troubles. There's where the real deliverance comes from. Verse 9, deliver me from my enemies, O Lord, for I have fled to you for refuge. The key word there is deliverance. And then teach me to do all your will. I want to learn something from this. I don't want to be back here again, for you are my God. And then finally, he closes it, let your good spirit lead me on level ground, that submission or surrender. So let's go back for just a moment to the second prayer. Let's go back to, it says, hide not your face from me, lest I be those who go down to the pit. And the key there is looking at and talking about the presence of God. The last thing you want when your back is against the wall is to be by yourself. When you're in that place, I want you to listen. I'm going to say that again. The last thing you want when your back is against the wall is to be by yourself. And you all know that's true. You've been there before. When you're in that place alone, your aloneness, listen, actually serves as an amplifier. It makes things worse. And you feel like you're in a pit and no one sees you when you're there. You're probably thinking, well, I know what comes next, Michael. You're going to launch into a talk about small groups, but I'm not. Now listen, small groups are wonderful. They're essential. We can't do life without them. They're powerful. But that is not what this passage is talking about. In fact, when your back is against the wall, you can be in a group of 25 people, 10 people, 100 people, and still feel like you're in that place, in a pit, all alone. You know it's true. In fact, sometimes the more people, the worse it gets. See, listen to me. What you need is presence, not people. What you need is his presence, not people. There is a place for people, but this requires his presence. David prays and says, don't hide your face. It's almost like there's a darkness. And David is crying out in the darkness, Lord, don't hide your face. Where are you? Lord, don't hide your face. David is looking for God. Say, can you do that in your devotions? Absolutely. You push aside that stuff and you open your heart and you pray from your emotions. I'll talk about that in just a second. And you say, Lord, don't hide your face. Let me know what you're saying. Let me know what you're doing. David's looking for God. And even when he can't see God, he's looking for him. The word presence is capitalized. Why? Because the presence is a person. He's the Holy Spirit. And he's in you. The Holy Spirit is in you and he's upon you and he's with you. Seek him out. Seek him and get personal. I'm telling you, when you're in this kind of place, don't waste it. Open up your heart to him. He's the safest person in the universe. Hide not your face from me, O God, he says. And pray from a place of feelings. Pray your emotions. Talk about what you're going through. Talk to him as if he's right there in the moment. Be real and be honest about where you are. The key is this. Talking to God opens the door for him to be talking with you. Talking to God opens the door for you to be talking with God. That's better said. I want to go down that trail so bad right now, but we're going to wait and talk about that next week. The key is this. Talking to God leads to talking with God. And when you sense his presence, listen to me. When you sense his presence, everything is about to shift. Your circumstances might say you're in the same place, but your heart and your spirit begin to lift. When you hear that still small voice, that whisper, your own spirit starts to rise. Why? Because your faith starts to rise and your faith begins to return. And you know that you're not alone anymore because his presence has come and the game has just changed. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So faith comes by hearing and hearing through the word of Christ. Again, I'm so eager to dig into this hearing portion. We'll get to that next week. But as you talk to God, you begin to hear from God, which sparks the fresh faith within you. And suddenly you're not alone. Suddenly the person of the Holy Spirit is with you. And when you, man, I can just sense it right now. When you sense his presence in that way, everything changes. There is no sin too great. There is no enemy too strong. There is no fear too debilitating. There is no sickness too darkness too terrifying. There is no depression too deep, no past too dark for the Holy Spirit to handle. Listen, he's the hero of every battle. He's the destroyer of darkness. He's the very power of God. And when he turns his face toward you, your victory is at hand. Seven powerful prayers. And it all begins with desperation. Answer me quickly, O Lord. Then it moves to David talking to God. Lord, hide not your face from me. Show yourself to me. Enter this pit. Next week, we'll talk about hearing from God. Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love. I can't wait for that. The final section of this little psalm, this powerful little psalm, is preservation. David prays and he says, for your name's sake, O Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring my soul out of trouble. Doesn't say get me physically, get my soul out of trouble. And in your steadfast love, you'll cut off my enemies. You'll destroy all my adversaries because I know you and you always and only do what is right. For I am your servant. And at the very end of the prayer, David surrenders to God. Let's bow our heads and pray. Don't pray out loud, but just pray in your heart with me. Pray this prayer. Lord, hide not your face from me. Take a deep breath and say, Holy Spirit, come and fill me. Reveal to me the heart and the mind and the will and the power of God. For I put my confidence and my trust not in the arm of my flesh, but in your grace and your power at work in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Keep your head bowed for just one more moment, if you will. Maybe you're listening to this message and your emotions are astir inside your heart. And you have a sense that there are people out there who really know God and you're not among them. And you're wondering, what did I do? Did I make a wrong turn somewhere in life? Have I offended God? Have I pushed him out of my life? The truth is, yes, you've offended him by your sins. And the further truth is you're gonna have to pay for those sins. But there is good news, which turns out to be the best news. It's that God loved you so much that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And if that's you, and you're in that place right now, and you want to acknowledge that, yes, you're a sinner, and you've sinned against God, and you need to be forgiven to be made right with God, I'm not going to ask you to embarrass yourself in any way. I'm going to pray. And I just need to know who is going to be included in that prayer with me. So if you would do this for me, text the name Jesus to the number you see on your screen. If that's you and you're saying, Michael, I want to come to know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I want to be forgiven. I want to be right with God. I'm in a cave and I need help. Text the name Jesus to the number you see on your screen right now. You say, what are you going to do with that information? We're going to get back to you. You're not joining anything. We're going to get back to you and see how we can serve you. So that's you. Text Jesus to the number you see on your screen and pray this prayer after me. Ready? All together. Say, Jesus, thank you that you died on that cross for my sins. Please come into my life, forgive me and cleanse me and make me right with God. Because from this moment forward, I'm yours and I'm going to follow you to the end of my days and beyond into eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. Congratulations. Love to hear from you. God bless you. Have a great day.
What a powerful message from Pastor Michael. As he concluded this message, he gave you an opportunity to begin a real relationship with Jesus. If you prayed that prayer, please text the name Jesus to the number that you see on your screen and pause this part if you need to. Once you text, you will receive a prompt and simply follow what's instructed. This is a very exciting moment in your life, and we at Manna Church would love to come alongside you and assist you as you begin your personal journey with Jesus. Manna Church, thank you again for joining us online today. If you would like someone to pray with you, take a moment to text the word prayer to the number that you see on your screen. We have a team that's ready and waiting to connect with you and see how we can pray for you in any area of your life. God bless you, Manna Church. We'll see you right back here next week.
Showed me who